This morning's session is a question-answer session. There is a question from Lars Jensen of Sweden that relates to two posts on Facebook timeline. The first post was on 19th of October 2013 that reads, "Concentration makes you one-pointed at a cost of discarding 99% of life. If you are solving a mathematical problem, you cannot listen to the words. They will be a distraction." Then the next post was on 19th of October 2015, 2 years after, "How to evolve and transform. Be absorbed in anything that you are doing. Be totally into it. Those few moments when you are totally absorbed in something are the moments when you are closest to God. Those are the moments of bliss and benediction." Now, based on these two posts, the question is, so should I absorb in what I am doing and in the same time discarding the 99% of life, or should I absorb and still be aware of what all that happens outside and inside me? This question need to be responded in a few ways, parts. First of all, you have to understand, what is a master? Is he a philosopher or something else? A philosopher focuses on consistency. His statements are consistent, but a master is not consistent. He is a physician. You come to a physician, he tests you, checks you, and he says you have high blood pressure. You are supposed to take these tablets. You continue to take the tablets, but you find not getting much relief. You go to another, after 7 days, you go to another physician and you tell him that I am taking these tablets because I was told that I have the blood pressure. He checks it. He said, "You don't have any blood pressure. You don't need to take these medicines." Is there any inconsistency? Another example, you come home and you tell your wife that I am very hungry, I need to get something to eat. So your little son also hears it. He said, "This is the time that I should make something for my dad." So wife gives you the food and you eat that. Afterwards, the son brings something for you to eat. He said, "Dad, you are hungry. You said you are hungry." "Yes, I am not hungry now." Is that behavior will be considered as inconsistent? Life is full of inconsistencies. One moment you are hungry, you eat. Next moment you are not. And when you say, "I am hungry," and after you have eaten, you say, "I am not hungry." 5 minutes ago you said, "I am hungry," and 5 minutes after you say, "I am not hungry." There is no inconsistency in it, because you have already eaten. Buddha is a physician. When someone came to him and he inquired, "Are you a philosopher or thinker? What is your way? And what do you do?" Buddha said, "I eat, I drink, I sleep." This is what everybody does, the philosopher said. But how many of you are aware of it? So first of all, you have to understand, a master is a physician. You go to a pharmacy, there are so many medicines. All the shelves are full of medicines, but not all the medicines are for your benefit. If you are like me, when I was a little child, we had a homeopathic medicine box which has the white glucose globules soaked into homeopathic medicines. The globules are to the size of small mustard seeds. It was the medicine box of Sufi Brijmohan Lal, which I don't know how it came to our home. and I had the habit of eating something sweet. If I take out the small globules from one bottle, it will be known. So I used to take out a few from this bottle, few from the next, and make up almost like a half teaspoon and used to eat it every day. And one day it was discovered that why the medicine box is getting less. I said, we are giving the medicines every day to the people who come, so it must get less. You cannot eat all these medicines that are available on the shelves of pharmacy. Now, next aspect, when a master is speaking to a person, he connects to his innerness first and he sees what is necessary for him. What is necessary for you may not be necessary for the other. If you are aware, then you can be benefited by it. When that is the reason that physician, when he examines a patient, he examines a patient one by one. He does not take the patient's en masse and examines them or gives them the medicine. A pharmacist can do, he can check the prescription of the doctor, and looking at that, you may find all the patients are almost suffering from the same kind of virus, and the doctor is prescribing these medicines, so he may give. But that is a risky thing. But in case of a master, when he prescribes a methodology, it is in relation to an individual. Now, there is a difference in the medicine and these techniques that are given. These techniques will not harm you. It may enhance your capabilities, but it will not harm you. Whereas medicines can harm you. So you have to keep this in mind. When these posts are posted on for the general public, it is posted with an intention that it will create an interest. Those who have the acumen, they will be able to go deeper into it, these aspects, or may raise a question or two. The first post says concentration. We have to understand what is concentration and what is not. Let me explain something first on the concentration. You are going into a room which is where the bulb has blown. You have to find something. You take a torchlight. Torchlight has a capability to focus light in one particular direction. Light converges in a particular spot. It does not diffuse. So you take the torchlight and you pinpoint the object. But there is another aspect. You change the bulb in the socket and turn it on. The light of the bulb does not focus in any particular direction. Instead, it illumines the whole room. So concentration is focusing your attention or light in one particular direction. And when you turn on the light in the room, it is an aspect of meditation. You are bringing the light to the dark corners of the room. Still, it may be necessary that if you have to find out, because the room is full of full of different articles, boxes and things like these. In between, still there may be a dark corner. You will need concentrate. You may need the focus with a torchlight to go into those corners. Keep this in mind. I will speak on the aspect of concentration and differentiate between the two. The ability to concentrate is not something to feel blessed about. It is an important aspect. It is frozen state of mind. a very narrow stream. You can see from the example of the light and the torchlight, the light bulb. The moment you turn on the switch, the whole room gets illumined. With torchlight, whichever direction it is going, only that area becomes illuminated. So it is a very narrow state of mind. You are moving your attention from all the other directions and focusing on one. It is useful, of course, very useful. Useful in scientific inquiry, useful in business, useful in market, useful in politics, but absolutely useless for yourself when it comes to inward journey. If you become too attuned to concentration, you will become very, very tense. Concentration is a tense state of mind. You will never be relaxed. Concentration is like a torch, focused, and consciousness is the lamp which is unfocused. Consciousness is the lamp which is unfocused. You put on the bulb in the socket and turn on the switch, the whole room gets illumined. You are relaxed. You do not have to be worried about that you are focusing in one corner and from the next corner a cockroach may come in, and if you are scared of cockroaches, you will jump. My whole effort is to teach you consciousness, not concentration. And this is the point to be remembered. If you become conscious, any moment you want to concentrate on a particular problem, you can. It is not a problem. But if you become too much focused on concentration, the vice versa is not true. From consciousness, you can focus on something. For instance, right now, my attention is on Leaves from the Sufi Heart, Volume 3. We are talking about the life and the works of the masters from early 18th century. How to go into that? First of all, you have to use your consciousness to delve into the life of a particular master. Then you have to use the concentration as well to write it. The other day I was writing on the life of Shah Abdul Ghani Khan, whose shrine is Bhugaon, and he was the fellow disciple of Fazl Ahmad Khan Raziyallah Ta'ala Anhu, who was the master of Lala Ji Raziyallah Ta'ala Anhu. Not much is known about him. So I have to take that aspect of my consciousness that can act as a torchlight and focus on that particular. But I am aware, the light is there. The light is lighting in the room. At the same time, I am using a torchlight to pinpoint the particular anecdotes, the incidents from the life and the works of the sheikh. Trying to recollect those incidents which were told to me almost 40 years, because now almost 35 years I am in Trinidad. So 40, 45 years ago, those had been told in bits and pieces by my grandmother, or I heard from my uncle or from my mother. How do I recollect those? The innerness, the inner space is illumined by consciousness. Then the torchlight of concentration is helping me to recollect those incidents so they do not get muddled. I am speaking a part of this and a part of that other incident. It will be muddled. So use concentration as well. But as such, if you are conscious and you are focusing on consciousness, you can use concentration as a tool. But the vice versa is not true. If you focus on concentration, then you cannot attain to consciousness. My whole effort is to teach you consciousness, not concentration. And this is the point to be remembered. If you become conscious, any moment you want to concentrate, you can. It is not a problem. But if you become too much focused with concentration, the vice versa is not true. You cannot relax. And that is the main point which has to be understood. A focused mind becomes obsessed, narrow. If you are a mathematician, you cannot think anything other than that. If you are a politician, your mind becomes narrow and your whole thinking becomes political. From time and again, I have given an example. Three people went to visit a particular place in the mountains. One was a poet, the other was an architect, and the third was a politician. There was a waterfall between the two hills, and the first one saw was a poet. He saw what a beautiful examples of nature's beauty. It seems the beauty is converged at this place, full of serenity, peace, and whatever words a poet can use, he used it. The next was an architect. What a beautiful example of nature's architect. No one has made it yet, still it is there, a piece of architect. How much human labor will it take to create such a piece of architect? Third was politician. What a criminal waste of nature's energy and resources. Had it been in my constituency, I would have won the election. This is the nature of concentration. It becomes narrow. It is not easy to be relaxed and leave the tension. It remains there. Meditation, on the other hand, will allow you to concentrate whenever the need arises. If you meditate, first concentration disappears and you will be feeling a little at a loss when concentration is disappearing, because this is something that we had known always. But if you go on, by and by you will attain to a state of unfocused state of light. That is what meditation is. Once meditation is attained, concentration is a child's play. Whenever you need to, you can concentrate. There is no problem about it, and it will be easy and without any tension. Right now, you are being used by society. Society wants efficient people. It is not worried in any way about soul. That is how the society, all around you are. It is worried about your productivity. I am not worried about your productivity. Man has already too much, more than he can enjoy. There is no need of anything otherwise. There is more need to play around more and more. There is need to be more conscious. Science has developed enough. Now, whatsoever science is doing is almost, in some cases, not necessary. Once you become trained in a particular thing, you can go in that line blindly. Unless a cul-de-sac happens, you cannot go anymore, but life is infinite. There comes no cul-de-sac. You can go on and on. Religious activity or meditation in particular is a totally a different story. It is not worried about being more efficient. The whole point is how to be more joyful, how to be more celebrating. If you are with me, by and by, concentration will relax. And in the beginning you will feel afraid, because you will see that your skill is disappearing, your efficiency is disappearing. You will feel you are losing something that you have gained with so much effort. In the beginning it will happen. The ice is melting and it becoming water. The ice was solid, something concentrated. Now it is water, loose, relaxed, flowing in all directions. But anytime you need ice, the water can be turned into ice again. There is no problem. Just a little more cooling is necessary and water will become ice. This is my own experience. When I say it from my own experience. The same has happened to me. First concentration disappeared, but now I can concentrate on anything. I am speaking. I have to use the language. I have to make the sentences and make sure that I do not deviate from the line that I am speaking on at the moment. This is an aspect of concentration and relaxation simultaneously. Meditation and concentration is happening simultaneously. Meditation is happening because there is light in the inner self, and concentration, as far as the use of language, formation of sentences is concerned. But I can concentrate on anything, there is no problem. But I do not remain in that state of concentration. I can come back and give you a joke or sideline and then come back on the main topic, and there will be no breakdown of the concentration. If at the moment while I am talking to you about concentration and relaxation, if I happen to give you a joke of Mullah Nasruddin, this is an important, let me give you a joke. It happened that it was Mullah Nasruddin became Hindu. And he started fasting like a Hindu will do during the fasting period. It was 9 days of continuous fasting when Hindus do the fasting. So he was not drinking at all. And one day, on the 8th day, all of a sudden, a voice emerged from the liver. The voice emerged from the liver, and Mullah Nasruddin realized that it is the voice coming from my liver. Boss, are you alive still or you are dead? A voice from the liver comes because he has not been drinking. Boss, are you alive or dead? I have given this joke, but I have not deviated from my path. You may get lost into this joke, but you may lose the track. I will come back to the same point. This is my own experience. Whatever I say it on my own experience. The same happened to me. First, concentration disappeared, but now I can concentrate on anything. There is no problem. But I do not remain in a state of concentration. Concentration and relaxation happen simultaneously. Whenever the need arises, just as whenever the need arises, you walk. You do not sit on the chair and go on moving your legs. There are few people who go on moving because they cannot sit and relax. You will call this man restless. Legs in perfect order are needed so that whenever you need to, you can walk. You can run. But when there is no need, you can relax. and legs will no longer be functioning. This is the state of a meditative person. But your concentration has become almost focused, as if you are continuously preparing as an Olympic runner, so you cannot relax. They have to run a particular amount every morning and evening. They are continuously on the go. If they relax for a few days, they will lose their skill. But I call all Olympics political, ambitious and foolish. There is no need. Competition as such is foolish. There is no need. If you are enjoying running, perfectly good. Run and enjoy. But why compete? Competition is pointless. It brings illness, unhealthiness. Competition brings jealousies and 1,001 other diseases. Meditation will allow you to concentrate whenever the need arises. But if there is no need, you will remain relaxed. You have legs totally functioning. You are sitting on the chair, legs don't need to move. But if you need to walk, you stand up and start walking. You were relaxed a moment before. Now you need to walk. The feet that were stationary begin to walk. Take strides. You can take a stride, you can walk at a slow pace, anything that you want to do. Meditation will allow you to concentrate whenever the need arises. But if there is no need, you will remain relaxed. Flowing in all directions like water, feel blissful, blessed. What is the point of uttering logical sentences? Utter nonsense. I am speaking. Is there any logic in that? Is there any logical? There is no logic. Simple sentences. Make sounds that may sound like gibberish, like birds, like trees. Look this way. Is there anything logical in it? The tree is enjoying, delighting, simply shedding away all the past. Delight, sing. Utter sounds, forget all logic, and by you will be more alive, less logical of course, and that is the price one has to pay. But you become dead. If you become more logical, and you become more alive if you are less logical. This is when you understand this. Now I am coming back to the two posts. The first that was posted on 19th of October 2013. That said, concentration makes you one-pointed at the cost of discarding 99% of life. A statement about concentration that explains what concentration is, the methodology, the mechanics. And then it says the usefulness of it. If you are solving a mathematical problem, you cannot listen to the words, because that will be a distraction. But now scientists say, for a better concentration, you can have a very relaxing music playing at the background and you can continue to do your work, like the works of Beethoven or the very soft classical music. You can play it at the background. So this is a concentration means you are discarding the rest and focusing in one direction. This statement clearly says, makes you one-pointed, like your torch is lit and it is being focused, pointed into one particular direction, and it is neglecting all the other directions. because a torchlight cannot focus on the entire room. Its light comes in the form of a beam, whereas the light of the bulb diffuses in the entire room the two different systems of light. They are made for two different purposes. When you are going into the forest for hunting, you do not need a bulb, and there is no possibility of carrying a bulb, the electric socket and bulb with you. You have to carry the portable light, which is in the form of a torchlight. You want to get your car fixed while on the street. Along the way, it breaks down. You need torchlight to focus on a particular problem. How to evolve and transform, the post on 19th of October 2015. How to evolve and transform. Be absorbed in anything that you are doing. This does not mean the word concentration is not coming here. Even if you are doing mathematical problem, if you are too much absorbed into it, automatically the light will begin to shine from there. I'll point out to you. Now I am taking myself to those moments when I am in the company of Sheikh Shakuntala Devi and she is telling me the anecdotes of Maulisa. I am going back into those moments. It is through the way of concentration I have gone into those moments. Now I am absorbed in that moment because it is a combination of meditation and concentration, so that at that point I may not be distracted. I am trying to recollect some of those incidents, some of those anecdotes which have been told to me from time to time. I am absorbed into it. I am in the company of the Sheikh. Through my way of relaxation as well as concentration, I am in that state. In the company, I am absorbed. And the moment you are absorbed, you are in the company of the Sheikh. This is how you can go in the company of those masters who are not alive anymore. Be totally into it. Those few moments when you are totally absorbed in something are the moments when you are closest to God. Remember when I was listening to it, when she has first narrated that incident to me, it was 45, 50 years ago, as a young boy, the attention was diverted, she is trying to tell me something, but I am not focused on it, I am not listening to it, because someone, friends are calling from outside, what are you doing there? Sitting with that old lady, come outside and let us go and play. So I'm not totally into it. But now I have realized, and the need calls for to go into those moments. You are going into the word that is to be used. You are going into the archives of your memory. And how can you enter? There is a way to enter into the archives. And then you have to be relaxed. You are in the company of Sheikh Shakuntala Devi. Now you are listening through your intuitive mind, through your kashp. Through your intuition, you are listening to what she has done. You are recalling all that has happened at that time. You are in a better position. That is why these are the moments of bliss and benediction, and you are closest to God. In the first instance when it happened, if I was there totally, Yes, because of the tawajjuh of energy field of the Sheikh, I can recollect it when it is needed. But to be more precise, I have to go back into that moment. You will recall when you are in the company of your Sheikh, and then when you come back and you try to introspect on the words, you are actually going deeper into it. You are introspecting on the words of the Sheikh, what he has told at that time in the congregation. Now you are all alone. You are introspecting on the words. You are being absorbed into it. And this is the way to evolve and transform. And when you are introspecting those words, you are looking at the gesture, the way the Sheikh had looked at you. The gestures, the intonations. And those moments are the moments of bliss and benediction. So should I absorb in what I am doing? And at the same time discard the 99%? It is not that you are doing it. It is the consciousness that is taking the course of itself. You are no more there. The moment you are absorbed, you are no more. Whatever is needed, the existence will make it happen that way. I am speaking to you when this question came to me. I wanted to respond in writing. But when I saw the benefit of it in speaking to the wider cross-section of the people, I thought of not writing it. And even if I had taken the pen to write it, all that I have spoken would have not been written. So, am I discarding 99%? No. I am responding. It will happen on its own, whatever is necessary at that moment. Existence will take its own course and allow it to happen. All I am interested in, bringing out those anecdotes about this particular Sheikh about whom not much is written. Only those messages which has been, this is called oral tradition, the way of Upanishads. The master tells the student, students try to absorb it within his consciousness, and then when he has to surface it, he has to use the technique, the tool of concentration. Concentration is a tool that is necessary. You want to pound a nail, you need a nail and you need a hammer. And if you are not focused, if you are not aware, you may pong at your thumb, or you may make a digged out painting on the wall. You have to focus where the nail can enter into the wall and what kind of nail you have to use. What these are all come in the aspect of concentration. Now you decide for yourself. So should I absorb in what I am doing and at the same time discard 99%? This question is coming out of the mind, not coming from the no mind. If it was coming from the no mind, you will not ask such question, but it is important a question is asked so that whatever aspects are not understood can be explained. When you are in a state of no mind, you are absorbed. Whatever at that time is necessary, existence will bring it to the surface. Now, in writing that particular chapter. Now when I write a particular chapter, I am absorbing in the consciousness of that particular shape. And all those who had been the contemporary. The Sheikh died in 1953. I was born in 1951, so I may not be able to recollect any of his incidents, any of those anecdotes. But my mother did. My grandmother did. My uncle did it. My Nana, the Sufi Braj Mohan Lal, did, but I was 3 or 4 years of age when he took Samadhi. So I have to, through the aspect of absorption, go into that with my intention that I want to bring out the anecdotes from the life of Shah Abdul Ghani Khan for the benefit of humanity, for the benefit of the seekers from all around. What is my objective? Not a competition, not a self-praise, but for the benefit of humanity, for the process of transformation of human consciousness, I want to bring those anecdotes from the life of Shah Abdul Ghani Khan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu. How to bring it? Those people who have been his contemporary and they have told me those anecdotes which I did not pay any attention, how am I going to go into those? I have to use the tool of concentration. First, absorption, meditativeness, relaxation, then using the tool of concentration. So while I am writing, the incidents do not get mixed up. It happens on its own. And when that chapter is finished, now I have to wait for another few days before I go into, first into absorption, then the existence will create all that is necessary and how much of that to be put into the book. The life and works of Lalaji and Chachaji as were penned by Sufi Braj Mohan Lal is voluminous, over 1,000 pages. That cannot be put everything into this particular volume. So a certain part of that. In the beginning I thought that I can put all that, but now I have to put an abridged aspect of that, that itself is complete, and the life and works of Lalaji, Chachaji and so can form another volume by itself. All this happens on its own. I am not making an effort. I am simply absorbed, meditative, relaxed. The rest is done by the existence. So you should forget everything else and be absorbed in what you are doing and allow the rest to happen on its own. Everything else will take place on its own, whatever is necessary at that moment. If you have to use the tool of concentration, existence will create that situation that you will use. But you have to be sincere in your connectivity with the existence and trust the existence so much that it can never do anything wrong. It will guide your steps moment to moment, and you will grow into awareness, evolve and transform. So how to evolve and transform? Be absorbed in anything that you are doing. Be totally into it. And those moments will be the moments that you are totally absorbed in something, or the moments you are closest to God, two things will happen. Whatever you are doing, it will be done in a relaxed way and it will have a far-reaching effect. Even if you are handling the problems relating to your work, you are entering into those problems meditatively. What did Madame Curie did? She was trying to solve the problem. She went meditatively into it. She was transformed. And also the problem was resolved and she won for that the Nobel Prize. So what will happen? You will feel a different kind of blissfulness into you, which will not give you, inflate your ego. Instead, a kind of a satiation when you are doing the work in that way is a different kind of a satiation comes to you. This is the process of evolution and transformation of consciousness. Experiment with it. I can go on and speaking, but the words fail to express that state. That is why I said I am speaking on the basis of my own experience. I focus on consciousness. Then whatever tools are necessary, they come onto the surface and they are used. When their use is not necessary, they go back into the place where they have come from. You can solve anything that way, worldly or non-worldly. So this is